This video will provide a brief history of uranium enrichment safeguards. The very first enrichment facilities in the world were built for military purposes and were used to produce highly enriched uranium. These facilities were in what later became known as nuclear weapon states, and so they were typically unsafeguarded. With the development of commercial nuclear power, however, the demand for low-enriched uranium increased in order to fuel these new commercial nuclear reactors. Most of the world's nuclear reactors used for power production rely on enriched uranium, since an increased uranium-235 content is required to sustain a chain reaction for long periods of time. Until the mid-1970s, a few nuclear weapon states monopolized the supply of enrichment services for commercial purposes. However, once gas centrifuge technology made enrichment capabilities more accessible, it became obvious that the non-nuclear weapon states would seek to acquire their own independent enrichment capabilities based on centrifuge technology. These facilities would obviously have to be placed under safeguards. For these reasons, work on safeguards procedures for enrichment facilities started relatively late. In addition, these procedures were largely focused on centrifuge facilities. IAEA studies at the time concluded that because enrichment plants have a high degree of operational flexibility, no simple safeguards concept existed that would be adequate for safeguarding centrifuge enrichment facilities. Centrifuge facilities also involve sensitive technologies. Facility operators were concerned that design information might be compromised by visual access to the machines, and the question of whether or not inspectors would have access to the cascade halls was a subject of considerable debate during negotiations on safeguards concepts for these facilities. The first IAEA model safeguards concept developed specifically for centrifuge facilities emerged in the early 1980s from the discussion and analysis of the hexapartite safeguards project. It was developed by the technology holders of the time during a time in which enrichment facilities began to spread to non-nuclear weapon states. The hexapartite safeguards project approach envisioned two conceptually different activities. The first of these included activities outside of the cascade halls. These activities were primarily based on conventional safeguards practices and are focused on material accountancy to deter or detect diversion of declared materials. The second group of activities took place inside the cascade halls, and these activities are largely carried out in order to verify that the facility is not producing any material beyond the declared enrichment level, and especially that there are no traces of highly enriched uranium production. These ideas have informed the current inspection regime, which consists of routine announced inspections for physical inventory verification. These inspections are intended to cover the nuclear material accountancy outside the cascade halls. Inspectors also make limited frequency, unannounced access inspections to the cascade areas to confirm the absence of highly enriched uranium production. For the reference enrichment facilities considered at the time, an inspection frequency of one inspection a month was deemed acceptable. These visits inside the cascade areas included environmental sampling to confirm that any deposited particles were free of evidence of HEU production. Inspectors also apply and verify seals to ensure continuity of knowledge. Ongoing safeguards activities inside the cascade halls include process monitoring and containment and surveillance measures. Thank you.